Starting the session today, we would like to start with Sai Gayatri, invoking our dearest Swami. Om Sai Ishwaraya Vidmahi Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannah Sarva Prachodayat. Om Sai Ishwaraya Vidmahi Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannah Sarva Prachodayat. Om Sai Ishwaraya Vidmahi Satya Devaya Dhimahi Tannah Sarva Prachodayat. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. So I would like to invite our dearest Dr. Gangadhar Shastri for this session. So starting with it, I would like to give a very small brief introduction regarding our dearest sir. Dr. Gangadhar Shastri is a serving faculty member of Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning. He retired in 2014, but ever since he has been serving Bhagwan as honorary professor. Dr. Gangadhar Shastri completed his BA with History, Economics and Political Science from Rajasthan University, MA in Political Science from Andhra Pradesh, Visakhapatnam, MPhil in History and Archaeology from Nagarjuna University, Guntur, PhD in Public Administration from Osmania University, Hyderabad. Dr. Shastri joined Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning in the year 1979 as first staff member in Political Science. Before joining Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning, he worked as a lecturer in Political Science at the most famous Loyola College. He has served Bhagwan as lecturer, senior lecturer, reader, and professor. Dr. Shastri has been blessed with countless numbers of interactions and interviews with Swami over the decades. He has published scores of articles on Swami in English and Telugu in spiritual magazines and journals. He has been traveling all around the globe to deliver lectures on Swami. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation and coming for this session. So I would like to say that you can continue your henceforth, and I wish you all the very best. Thank you, sir. Sai Ram.
Om Sri Sai Ram. Offering my most prayerful salutations at Bhagavan's lotus feet, I would like to share some of my important thoughts and also experiences with Bhagavan Baba, especially which I would like to center around the concept of Bhagavan's saying, a very famous saying of Swami, love is my form. Bhagavan Baba declared to the world any number of times that his form was that of love. Probably till today, however much mankind tried to understand the depths of this concept called love, I do not think that we ever really understood what it is. Because to be loving, not in the sense of the ephemeral love that we talk about in the world, but in the sense of divine love, a pristine love, a kind of pure love, love for the sake of love. It's not easy. It's not generally found so very easily in the world, not accomplished. The one country in the world which talked about it, which propagated it, which also showed to the world how to love, love in quotes, in the form of divine love, the entire world, it is only probably India. India is one country which taught the entire world what exactly we mean by this divine love and also how to practice it. Another fascinating aspect of this kind of teaching which has gone round the world from India is that this teaching is not a kind of thing that originated in recent times. No. Times immemorial. Since times immemorial, this country taught the entire universe, world, how to love. And what you mean by love, how to practice love. Bhagavan Baba, whenever he gave a discourse, very often he gave discourses, which I would like to describe as Bodha. Bodha is to be translated as preaching. One of the most important missions of Bhagavan Baba was to preach the world. What was the preaching about? The preaching was about love, how to love, and also why to love. Why you need to love anything in this world first of all. According to Swami, you love the world for the very sake of love, which would ultimately result in one very important aspect. That important aspect is sanctification of one's own life. You have to sanctify your life. Again, as human beings, we are sure to ask, why should we sanctify our lives? The answer is quoted by Swami from Vedas. He very often talked about sanctifying life is necessary because we need to get out of this cycle of birth and death. Again and again coming into this world, going through trials and tribulations, all kinds of problems. In case we are interested in avoiding this kind of a cycle, if we are interested in getting out of this cycle of punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, about which Sri Adi Shankaracharya, the Jagadguru, also spoke and Bhagavan quoted extensively, we need to enter into always good actions. Simply not good actions. There is the concept which is propagated through Vedas again, again and again and again, brought to our notice by saints, sages, seers and realized souls all through, known as Trikarana Suddhi. Trikarana Suddhi is very, very important. Manasyekam, vachasyekam, karmanyekam, mahatmanam. That is love. If you really love the world, and if you really love yourself more than loving the world, you have to be truthful to yourself. By being truthful to you, you need to do something which actually portends on the point that in your inside and outside, you are one and the same. Bhagavan Baba, on a number of occasions, pointed out that human birth, which is a highly significant birth, because again he quoted from the scriptures and said, Jantunam Narajanma Durlabham. It is impossible to gain the human birth. You have to go through a cycle of births before you attain this divine aspect of being a human. To be a human is not easy. In some of the scriptures, it's very beautifully described that even angels aspire to be human beings on the planet, to live for some time as human beings. By serving the universe, they would love to sanctify their own lives. As and when we talk about sanctification of life, to be one and the same within you and without you, outside you and inside you to be one and the same, many people would ask, is it necessary to be like that? And what are the benefits of being like that? The simple answer would be, when you are one and the same inside and outside, you are a very healthy being. You are maintaining a kind of calmness that is indescribable within you. You are calm, you are quiet, you are peaceful, you are joyous with yourself. I am very clear about what I am talking. There are a lot of people, or a very large majority of people in the world today, who appear to be something, but they are totally different. They talk something, they mean something. They say something, they do something else. Why? There is a dichotomy. There is a kind of duality. This duality is the cause of all problems in the world, which the universe senses. The universe itself has got the power to sense, because it is the universal consciousness that functions 24 hours, whether you understand it or not. It is working all the time. You may relax. The consciousness is not relaxing. The universal consciousness is to be carefully studied and not simply understood. The universal consciousness is a concept which is to be digested. It should flow along with your blood in all your veins and should be reflected in all your thoughts, in whatever you speak, in whatever you do, whatever you look at, whatever you listen to, everything. Because the universal consciousness, when we speak about, some people would ask, what is that actually? How does it function? How does it work? In modern times, people are more worried about the materialistic aspect of life. It's all materialism. How many more and more degrees I hold, how much of power I possess, how much of money I possess, and aspiring for more and more of influence, fame, name has become the order of the day. It is visible. It is strikingly visible, because it is practiced by almost all human beings all over, everywhere on the planet. In the process of working for fame, name, reputation, material benefits, they don't mind leaving, dropping the most important, significant spiritual qualities, which are the original nature of human being. When you were born, you were not like this. Lot of talks are given, lot of exposition is done on childhood. And in the childhood, how pure the mind is, how pure the heart is, how pure their words are, their thoughts are, their actions are. Everything is understood very clearly, and we are watching, because we are dealing with children even today. As you enter a class, you see a lot of children there. How they behave, all the small, small, small children. As you go on growing in your life, you are collecting a lot of bad baggage and begin to carry it with you, which bring all kinds of bad qualities, and you begin to nourish all those bad qualities, thereby you lose the pristine quality of love. You are not able to love. You have to ask yourself a question. Do I love people? If at all I am loving people, am I loving people for any benefit in return, or I am loving them just for the sake of love? There is a lot of between loving with expectations and loving people with no expectations at all. Whatever we do in modern times, at our personal level, to be very honest with ourselves, we love people with expectations. There's no doubt about it. Everybody, even in case he says that he loves his wife, he loves his children, he loves some people as his friends, wherever you go, you find that something very bad is happening there. Because this kind of a love is getting polluted with what is called as expectations in turn. Whenever you are loving somebody with expectations, with something which you are expecting in return, your love is getting polluted. And I think that you understand the meaning pollution. Are you loving somebody just for the sake of love? Are you helping really somebody with no expectation in turn? Are you going to the rescue of somebody with expecting nothing in turn? Are you doing that? The answer probably would be a definite no. No, we are not doing it. That is so because there is no unison between the thought, word, and deed. All three are not one and the same. Bhagavan Baba, on a number of occasions, pointed out in a number of discourses to his devotees and also to students and also to the world at large. He said, as long as thought, word, and deed are not one and the same, you cannot be pure at heart. And when you are not pure at heart, that's going to give you bad returns. You will have to suffer. Suffering does not mean physical suffering. Could be. It is a part of suffering, actually, physical suffering. There are different kinds of sufferings. There are different aspects of thoughts. There are different aspects of wisdom and knowledge which are to be carefully understood by each and every person. To give you one example, everything has got two aspects. There is apparently a duality in the unity, that which does not reveal itself so very easily. What is the duality, for example? For example, when I talk about duality, you are internally something and externally something. There is a duality. You are speaking something, but you are thinking of something else. Your thought is different, but the expression is different. Most of the times, most of the human beings in the world, they say something, but they mean something, and which sometimes takes the form of jealousy. Bhagavan Baba, talking about jealousy, he said, this is something, a quality, which is very much present there in the human beings, which is worse than cancer. You are jealous. Why you are jealous? You are jealous because somebody is more handsome, more beautiful. Somebody has got a better personality than you. Somebody got better marks than you. Somebody got a better job than you. He earns more than you. or somebody's child accomplished something which your child did not accomplish. All these things, 24 hours comparison, compare, and feel sad about it. We are comparing ourselves with everybody else in this society, and when somebody is a little better off in the material sense, we begin to feel sad about it, and also we begin to inwardly dropping down. Inwardly, you drop down. Your charm is lost, your smiles are lost, and also you become completely different. You are not yourself. That's absolutely not right. Manasyekam vachasyekam karmanyekam is something which is talked about with reference to great accomplished souls. With great people. In ancient Indian times, when we talk about the Vedic ages, even before Vedic ages, when we talk about saints and sages, tapasvis, Vasishtha, Vishwamitra, Jamadagni, Durvasu Maharshi, and so many other, Kashyapa, so many of them. They are all the original wealth of India. They are all the real soul of India. They are all the real strength of India. They are all what India stands for. Our sages, our saints, our seers. Somebody would definitely ask, Vasishtha, Vishwamitra, Jamadagni, and all of them you are talking about, and we don't know about them because we never read about them. That's okay. If you did not read, it's not late. You can read at least now. And when you say that, we do not know whether they really did all that what is extolled in books. We get it from scriptures. Maybe somebody authored. How do we understand the spirit of it? Okay. Medieval times, you have lots and lots of them. In modern times too. Maybe I can just remind you about Ramana Maharshi. You cannot say that Ramana Maharshi is something which is a cooked up story. You cannot say Raghavendra Swami is something like a cooked up story. You cannot say Shirdi Swami or Satya Sai Baba. Or for that matter, so many sages and saints who are living in various ashrams across India even today. Even today, lots and lots of service activities are undertaken by several institutions, several organizations being run by several people. You are not doing it, you do not know, is not the reason for you to support yourself. You are not able to do it because you never thought about it, nor you did not even attempt to learn or know about it. That's your mistake. And at the same time, if you are really interested in leading a good life, good in quotes, a calm life, a quiet life, a happy life, a healthy life, the only path open to human beings is the path of spirituality. Spirituality is nothing but just love. All spirituality talks about love, just love. When I talk about all spirituality, I talk about all kinds of paths that are taken towards the divinity. Bhagavan Baba, while talking about religions and while established actually Sarvamata Stupa at Prashanta Nilayam, he declared to the world, all the religions in the world preach you the good only. Which religion ever taught you bad? Matamalanni yucheri manchine bodhinchu. All religions preach you good. Matulu manchuvaina matamedi chaddati. If your mind is good, which religion is bad? Matulu manchuvaina matamedi chaddati. Which religion is bad in this world if your mind and heart are good and pure? All religions are like paths leading to the same divinity, just as all the rivers flow into the ocean. You are not opening up your mind, but you are trying to weaken your vision. And also, you are trying to have a narrow look at everything in this world. Broaden your vision, broaden and broaden and broaden. Love everything and everybody around you. The question asked generally is, when there are a lot of people who hate you, who don't love you, how do you do it? And Bhagwan Baba gave a wonderful answer. Bhagwan Baba said, if all the people are doing bad and not loving, you also join them. What is the difference between them and you? What is the difference between them and you then? All of them walk on the wrong road and you also want to join them. What is the great difference? What was the difference of the road that was taken by Mahatma Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, or Abdul Kalam? What was the road taken by Tyagaraja? What was the road taken by Annamayya, Ramadasa, Tukaram, Mirabai? You cannot say these souls were not there. They existed in recent times. What did they do? They loved and loved and loved. Swami quoted all of them, several discourses, any number of times. Ever since Bhagwan Baba declared himself to be an incarnation when he was a boy, when he was a boy, Shankaracharya declared himself when he was a boy. Ramana Maharshi entered into spirituality when he was a boy. And what we think today is, it is not time for me to undertake bhajans now. Let me be 60 years. Let me above 60. Let me retire. Then I will start. There is a proverb in Telugu which says, Mokkai vanganadi manai vrunguna. When you are not a sapling, when you are not able to straighten yourself and put on the right road, how do you think you could do it when you are old? Bhagwan Baba said, one purpose of starting all educational institutions by me is to introduce spirituality to all the children at a very young age. That is the reason why he started actually all the educational institutions through which he wanted to give wonderful, highly useful, disciplined, committed international citizens to the world. People who are honest. He was a bit pained on a number of occasions when he talked about the dishonesty, which is very much evident in people today, and also lack of commitment on the part of people, and how actually they were destroying their own lives. The simple principle Bhagwan Baba taught all of us is, it's a quotation, love thy neighbor as thyself. Love thy neighbor as thyself. Are you able to do it? Are you able to? You are not doing it. You are 24 hours scheming to harm others in the society. How to become a wealthy person by cheating somebody else. Everywhere, all through our lives, we are scheming and scheming and scheming. We are forgetting the most important fact when we are scheming about harming others. The most important fact is, Bhagwan Baba repeatedly said this, and I want all of you to have this point in mind. Parulu parulu kadaya paramatmakani. Parulu parulu kadaya paramatmakani. Never think the other man is other man. No, you are yourself to be seen in him. He is no way different from you. You and him are one and the same. That unity. Adi Shankaracharya, when he faced a chandala, and when he asked him to move out, move aside, give me way, that chandala asked him a question. Swami repeatedly brought that point to our notice. He told us again and again and again. What did Chandala ask Shankara? He said, what you want me to set aside? What is it to be set aside? Move aside. What is that? Do you say that this body should move aside or the soul within that should move aside? Which is that? Immediately revered the Chandala for bringing him to the wonderful reality that the body is a transient and everybody carries the most significant soul within it, which is the power. And it is the soul which we need to understand. And it is the soul which we must keep in our mind as we keep on working in this world, in whichever position you are working, wherever you are, in whatever condition you are. You have to go on loving and loving and loving. That's all. Love, love, love. Expansion is love. Through love, anything is possible in the world. By loving, you can accomplish anything. Not by hating. Not by criticizing. By hating and by criticizing, you are definitely ruining your own future and your inner being is getting polluted. Your inner being is pure and pristine. Let that inner being be pure. The purity is to be carefully protected all the time. It should remain pure all your life. That is what actually the saints and sages and saints taught us. If we are not accessing spiritual wisdom by reading Ramayana, Bharata, Bhagavata, we need to do it now at least. Better late than never. Bhagavan Baba in the university introduced a number of courses. Being a distinct university from all other universities, we have got special courses which actually try to bring out the human quality within us. You are basically a human being. First of all, realize that you are a human being. Are you carrying those human qualities within you? That is the question. And Swami taught, as I mentioned, ever since he declared himself to be an incarnation, the five values that are to be cultivated by each and every individual, starting from his very childhood. As he goes through the system of education, master these five qualities, because these are called pancha pranas. These are the five vital life elements. Satya, Dharma, Shanti, Prema, Ahimsa. Satya, Dharma, Shanti, Prema, and Ahimsa, Bhagavan taught. And the most important point which I want to bring to your kind notice is not Bhagavan Baba preaching, Bhagavan always practiced. Preaching anybody could do. You can simply go on preaching. Practicing values is the toughest part. And Swami said, at least practice one. All the five to be practiced is considered to be a distant dream. It's a very tough job. At least practice one. Satya, try to be truthful. Dharma, be righteous. All your life be righteous. Ask yourself a question. Whenever you are thinking of something, thinking, not doing, at the level of thinking itself, when a thought comes to your mind, just ask yourself, is it a dharmic thought? Your mind should be trained in such a way as to entertain only dharmic thoughts. When bad thoughts come to your mind, immediately you should throw it out. Let never bad thoughts enter my mind. Swami asks all our students every day to chant Sahana Vautu, Sahana Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karvavahe, Tejasvinavadhitamastu, Mavidvishavahe. Our boys chant every day. Let me have good thoughts. Let me have good looks. Let me listen to only good things all the time. Swami said, when somebody comes and speaks bad things to you, run away from them. Never again talk to him. Because he is trying his best to pollute your mind. But unfortunately, whenever somebody comes and tries to put bad thoughts into your mind, they get so luring. They become so luring. You get lured by it. And they appear to be so sweet. And you would like to continue. Come on, tell me more. Forgetting the fact that you are poisoning your mind. It is getting poisoned. Even when you are watching programs, whenever you are watching programs which pollute your mind, you should never watch. Any program which gives calm to you, which gives quietness to you. There is a reason why satsanga, you must be always in the company of good people. There is a reason Bhagavan Baba said, Kuru sadhu samagamam. Be in the company of good people all the time. Who speak about Vedas, who speak about Upanishads, who speak about service to the society, who speak about bhajans, who speak about participating in social service activities all the time. That's why Bhagavan Baba started a huge Satya Sai organization. All over the world, we have branches in all countries, on all continents, everywhere. All people are attracted. They are very busily engaged in service activities all the time. They are attracted. They are brought into this by Bhagavan Baba. They are all serving. Swami is known all over, almost everywhere, in every nook and corner of the world. He made such a huge impact because of only one thing. He began to love. He began to practice. If I may say so, pardon me for saying this. I do not really mean, but I want to convey a wonderful thought. That is the reason I am saying this. If at all he was worried, the word is not to be used with reference to Bhagavan Baba, but let me use it. If at all he worried all the time, all through as he walked on this planet for more than 7 decades, what was he more worried about? 7-8 decades. He was worried about only one thing. How to work for the sanctification of more and more and more and more lives on the planet. How do I do that? How to reach out to millions and millions in all nooks and corners of this world and turn them into good souls, beautiful souls who commit themselves to serve and serve and serve without expecting anything in turn. Enter into service, enter into service, serve the people all the time. Somebody comes and asks, they do it. Don't ask him, if I do this, what do I get? If you are doing something, by taking something, how do you think that you are serving anybody? You are not serving anybody. You are exploiting somebody. Today, if we are offering some service, we are charging 10 times more than what amount of service we are receiving from others. If you want me to give a lecture, how much do you pay me? If you want me to teach, how much more you pay me? If you want me to do some work for you, how much are you going to pay me? Everything is measured in terms of payment without realizing that what kind of service you are offering to the society. Why society? Because you are what you are because of the society. It is the society which is responsible for what you are. It is the society which paid billions and billions of rupees for all the universities to be conducted, all industries to be built, all roads to be built, all communications, transportation facilities, all kinds of facilities that you are enjoying today. Just look back and think for a minute. You are enjoying because the society is supporting you. You are enjoying a wonderful breakfast. See the poor soul of a farmer behind your breakfast on the table. There is a farmer who is cultivating all those things, scorching himself under the sun, drenching himself under the rain, sleeping on the fields in the nights, unlike you on Dunlop beds at room. There are so many people. The milk vendor who brings milk to you early morning. When you open the tap, you get water. There is somebody at a water tank opening the valve early morning at 3 o'clock without sleeping. There are soldiers on the borders not sleeping to see that you sleep comfortably in your bed. There are so many people working round the clock to keep you happy. What are you paying? You are not paying anything, nothing. Not only that, you are asking them to serve you more and more and more. You don't do anything, but you want somebody to do all the time something to you. Why? Is it right on your part? When we ask this question, somebody might ask, why not I ask some people to serve me? Because I am more intelligent. I have got better qualifications. I have got a lot of knowledge and all that. So I am doing it. But at the same time, Bhagavan Baba said, before you ask so many questions, ask yourself a number of other significant questions also. What are all those questions? Most significant questions which will shock you. You will be bewildered when you ask all those questions yourself. You will be completely blown apart when you ask those questions to yourself. You are brilliant. You are very intelligent. So you want to exploit other people. They need to pay you more for all the kind of service that you are offering to them. You think, what are you paying to the Lord Sun who rises in the east every day without fail for millions and millions of centuries, going on rising in the east, setting in the west? What about the moon? What about the stars? What about the rains that go get in seasons perfectly? What about the earth that gives you so many kinds of varieties of food? What about all the rivers that flow incessantly giving you beautiful water? What about all the clouds that pour down valuable water for you to quench your thirst? What about the wind that blows so calmly and quietly and makes you really feel comfortable and breathe in and out? What are you paying? What about all the beasts that are serving you? What about a cow? What about a goat? What about actually talking about sheep? So many animals, so many birds. Such foliage, beautiful forests all around. Wonderful forests that sustain you on this planet. The oceans that are roaring 24 hours, giving so many things in return to the human beings. What are we paying? What are we giving? Above all, there is actually the universal consciousness, as I mentioned, whom we address as God, who is kind and giving me so many things. To all of us, he is giving so many things. What kind of gratitude that we are showing to this? Love. You need to love everything in this universe, because one day Bhagavan Baba said, there is nothing that is useless in this creation. Everything is created with a purpose by God. And what is the principle that you understand, or you need to understand, to love everything in this world? Bhagavan Baba taught us the most important principle, which we have to contemplate on all the time, is interdependence. Interdependence. We are all dependent on one another for our comfortable living on this planet. We are all dependent on one another. The entire creation sustains itself through helping each and everything that is existing on this planet. Interdependability, interdependence. Understand this. Contemplate on this, just as you contemplate on Om Namo Narayanaya, Om Namah Shivaya. As you chant Om Bhur Bhushyuhan Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimai Dhiyo Yanu Prachodaya, to contemplate on dependency. Interdependent. We are all interdependent, and there is nothing that is not useful on this planet for something or the other. Everything is useful. Everything. Bhagavan created everything. Desserts, there is a cause. For the deserts to exist, mountains, there is a cause. Everything on this planet, everything around all of us with all other planets, everything around with all the stars in the space, with all the galaxies that are there, all natural forces teaches one thing: we are all interdependent and interconnectivity. Interdependent and interconnectivity, that is the central core aspect of love. Love it. That is God. And God is Bhagavan Baba. Bhagavan Baba, ever since he declared his incarnation, he went on preaching us again and again and again. He was teaching, going on teaching day in and day out. All his life he went on teaching. Along with teaching, he was practicing. He was loving everyone around, everyone. He loved all the people all over the planet. Everything existing on the planet. He taught us love, love, love. Declared himself, love is my form. I will love, love. To bring one point to your notice, having been here for almost 4.5 decades now, very, very soon I'll be completing 4.5 decades of my stay in Bhagavan's lotus feet. I knew lots and lots and lots of people were there who criticized Bhagavan Baba on various counts. A number of people were sometimes on a war path. Swami was undeterred. No, he was never worried about it at all. And whenever they came to him for something or the other, they received probably the best kind of treatment, as if he loved them more than anybody else. He said, I'm not bothered when somebody loves or not. I don't expect also. I don't want. I'm not interested. Because my nature is to love. A beautiful cloud carrying water, its nature is to rain. It rains, that's all. You need not ask. A beautiful tree, it bears fruits for you. It doesn't eat the fruits. Its nature is to bear fruits. A river so calmly and quietly and beautifully flowing, it doesn't drink its water. When you drink water, it feels happy. In the nature, everything in the nature is happy because it knows how to give and give and give and be happy by giving and giving and giving. And we take and take and take and forget and forget and forget. Love lives by giving and giving and giving. Self lives by forgetting, forgetting, forgetting. That's not the way. When are we going to really realize ourselves? By serving. So you have to keep on and on serving and serving without expecting anything. This is what is taught through Bhagavad Gita as well. Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita declared to the world, Karmanyeva adhikarasye ma phalesu kadachana. You have only the right to fulfill your responsibilities, just not to the society, just not to the society. Expand your mind. You have the duty to discharge your responsibilities towards your village, towards your district, towards your state, towards your country, towards the world, and toward the universe. The entire universe. Whenever bad thoughts come to you, those are like the ripples that emerge from the calm waters when a stone is thrown into those waters. Whenever a bad thought arises from your mind, it creates ripples in the entire environment around you. It pollutes the environment, every bad thought. You enter a house where actually 24 hours the people are listening to Namakam, Rudram, Namakam, Chamakam, Vishnu Sahasranama Stotram, Lalita Sahasranama Stotram, 24 hours in that house. There are wonderful vibrations all over there. They are enjoying all the time. On the other hand, you expose a person to cruel thoughts, brainwash him. You can very easily convert him into a human bomb. It all depends on what kind of food we give to the human being and also to his mind. A very good soft food actually makes a soft, wonderful individual. And soft knowledge, divine knowledge, spiritual wisdom all the time given to individuals would turn them into sages and saints. Bhagavan Baba, ever since he started educational institutions with the intention of giving international citizens to this world, produced thousands and thousands and thousands of students. We have a lot of information from various quarters, not only from India, but from various countries, wherein our students are working, where they say the employers are extraordinarily happy with our students because they commit themselves to the work so much with love that the employer is fascinated. And willingly, lovingly. Because Bhagavan Baba always taught love work. Love work. There is a famous statement made by man. Do not aspire always for the work that you love. Never aspire for some work which you love. I want only to be a lecturer. I want only to be an engineer. I want only to be a doctor or something like that. I want to choose a profession. Then I'll be happy. No. Bhagavan Baba always said, learn to live the work you get. Learn to love the work you get. Any work is work. And the ultimate excellent exposition of this idea when Bhagavan Baba said work is worship. Take work to the level of worship. In whichever office I'm working, my work is worship. It's an offering at the lotus feet of God from morning till evening in whichever office we are working. Consider that work as worship. Though it is a saddening sight in most of the places, people, they do not just not love their work, but they kill work. For every work, there is a price. For everything I want. We are suffering from the most dangerous outcomes or dangerous elements prevalent in the society today called nepotism, red tapeism, corruption, whatnot. So many. Well, what is it that we are doing actually by indulging in activities like that? We are not aware that we are causing pain to so many souls which walk into our offices for due work to be done to them, due service to be offered to them. One day when I was blessed with an opportunity to talk in the presence of Swami, I made a point. I said, we always call it government service. What are you doing? I'm in government service. Don't say that. please don't say that you are not serving. Government is equal to, as per political science lessons, its people. And you are doing service to people. You say it is a disservice that you are doing. You are causing so much of pain to people. When they go there, you are torturing them. You are causing so much of harm to them. You are ill-treating them. You are dishonoring them. You are disrespecting them. So many souls. Do you think you are going to be happy? According to the Karma Siddhanta of the Indians, that not only rottens you, but also your future generations. You will have to pay the price for it. So many people suffer. So many people. You are torturing people by not doing your job, what you are supposed to do. They are not asking any extra favors from you. Not at all. Don't do it. Torture them, threaten them, exploit them, insult them, humiliate them. Whereas Bhagavan Baba said, the gates of Prashantaranam are 24 hours open for everybody to walk in. And what is it that you do when you enter into Prashantaranam? Do one thing, Bhagavan Baba declared to the world. Leave all your problems with me and take happiness from Prashantaranam. Leave all your burdens to me. I am here with heavy shoulders to carry all your problems on my shoulders. I will give you joy. In the world, what we are doing is we are robbing off all kinds of joy from people and we are giving them terrible suffering. But Bhagavan Baba started educational institution. Look at it. He doesn't charge a single paisa. No charge at all. Swami himself mentioned to me, there is no fee receipt, first of all, in our institute. And in the fee receipt, there are columns, you know, sometimes. Towards games, this fee. Towards extracurricular activities, this fee. Towards a dress, this fee. Swami said, no fee. No fee at all. We give everything free. Why? I love them. Above all, Bhagavan Baba made a declaration to us teachers in the year 1979. First time when I joined the college, Swami used to come every Sunday to motivate us. Every Sunday, he used to come after bhajans, spend at least 1 hour with us in the institute. And he used to sit on a sofa. We were all sitting around him and he always told us one thing. You teachers do one thing. Swami, what is it that you want us? He said, I don't say he said. Let me say, he pleaded with us. When I think of those things, it brings tears into my eyes. His concern was so great. He told us, please teach my children with total commitment. You know, my children, all the students who come to my institute are my children. You know why? Because their parents send all their children to me with so much of confidence that they would certainly become better human beings. Solid, good individuals. With that faith, they send their children to me. And tomorrow, if something goes wrong with them, it is like me failing their faith in me. I don't want to do that. They have so much of faith in me. And you do this. You see to it that you become instruments in my hands, in strengthening their faith in me. And in turn, what I will do, you know, I will take care of your children. You consider all those children as your children and I will take care of your children. And Swami said, there is one more reason also why you need to do that. What Swami? Swami said, they are all to be considered as Premaputras. Yours are Kamaputras. Premaputras. All our students are Premaputras. They are all our children. A teacher, when he enters into a classroom, when he has got this commitment in his mind that I am teaching my children. I focus on every child. They are my children. As much as I teach my child at home, with what kind of commitment? The same commitment. For that, I need to love. I have to purify my mind and fill my mind and heart with pure love. Swami taught us that. Kamaputras, your putras are all desire, born out of desire. Prema putras are always much better. So, in the university, in all our campuses, in all schools, wherever there is a Satya Sai school, all teachers, all administrators, they love children so much. And our students also in turn love us so much. But in other students, other universities, what happens? Swami said, when they are going there, what are they doing? They are buying degrees. You are paying a lot of money and you are buying degrees. Nobody cares for anybody. Teachers, do they love their children so much in the university? Do students really think of their teachers as really the divine inspirers? Do they have that? No, it's a business bond. You are paying me something, I am teaching you something. That's all. I am paying something, I am coming to the class and learning something. No, no, no business at all. Business term does not exist in the dictionary of Bhagavan Baba. It does not exist in the dictionary of all those people who are committed to Swami. No business at all. It is all pure love. It's love. I do it because I like it. I love it. When my children come up, they are enjoying wonderful positions in the society. I'm extremely happy that my children are all very happy there. Swami did it without expecting anything from any child. Till today, for the past 40 years, more than 40 years, the university produced so many students who are all highly positioned in various places, in various corners of the globe. Swami is so happy about them. And whenever children ask Swami, Swami, we want to do something for you. What do you want us to do? Bhagavan Baba said, do something for me. What is it? You love your parents as much as you love me. That's it. You love your parents. Keep your parents happy. Listen to your father and mother. That is as good as serving me. Not only the educational institutions, the projects undertaken by Bhagavan Baba, which are reflections of his love for humanity, are so enormous that you cannot even visualize it in your mind. For example, the super speciality hospitals established by Swami by spending millions and millions and millions of rupees offering medical service to people who come from various parts of the country with no distinction of color, caste, creed, religion, nothing. Especially medicine. Medical attention, you know how expensive it is today. But in all our hospitals, it is totally free. And also Swami gave a direction to the world by starting mobile hospitals. Rayalaseema being actually a place, Puttaparthi, surrounded by so many villages struck with poverty, Swami sends all these mobile hospitals to various villages and gives medical attention to all people in all villages, free of cost, free of cost, free of cost, completely free. Not even a single rupee, civil naya paisa. And doctors also serve with so much of love. Swami one day made a wonderful comment while talking about hospitals to us. He said, when people come to our hospital, they recover very fast and go away back home very quickly compared to other hospitals outside. Why? Swami said, you know why? Because in our hospitals, when they come inside, they begin to listen to bhajans. It is all purified with pure thoughts, entire hospital, spiritualized. All doctors treat the patients with tremendous love, not having their eyes on the pockets of the patients, but on the hearts of the patients. And the nurses who give them treatment, the food that we give free to all the patients in the hospital, spiritual, everything is spiritualized. the spiritualized treatment, the spiritualized service heals people faster than the fear with you enter hospital, the fear with you are spending your time in hospital, the kind of self-centered attitude with which doctors treat you, the selfishness with which everybody is looking at you in the hospital, including the assistants. It is all sinful area, sinful atmosphere which is created there. Whereas we create a spiritual love environment charged with love, pure love, love on love on love. That's because of Swami. Finally, the water project, an excellent water project. People are drinking water today. It goes to every doorstep in entire Rayalaseema area and also to various places. Swami gave water to Chennai. Swami gave water to Srikakulam district people, Mehboob Nagar people, so many other people. Swami went on giving water and water and water. Why? In Noida, people don't get water every day. You get probably weekly once or so sometimes, maybe 15 days once. In Puttaparthi and all other Rayalaseema areas, which according to a UN study, is likely to convert itself into a desert at the earliest time, growing into a desert the fastest rate, people get all through the week, every day, 24 hours by 7 water here. A project undertaken by Swami on which Bhagavan Baba spent several crores and crores and crores of rupees. So what he said, you know, once the water project was completed, all the people from all villages all around Puttaparthi, lots of people, presidents and vice presidents, village panchayat presidents and others, more than 1,000 people came to Prashanthalayam. I was sitting there. On my right, they were all sitting in Prashanthalayam for darshan. Bhagavan Baba came after finishing darshan on the lady side and gent side, stood in front of them and asked, Bangaru, why are you all here? Bangaru, all people, why are you here? Why did you come? They all got up on their knees and said, Bhagavan, you gave us water, which was never given for the past 500 to 600 years by anybody. Today we are getting water at doorstep. Everybody at doorstep gets water in entire Rayalaseema today. You gave us by spending so much money with so much of love for all of us. We are here to express our gratitude to you, Swami. And I was a witness to this conversation because I was sitting there. Swami was standing by my side and talking to them. Swami said, Yanta tappu bangaru, yanta tappu. Which means, what a mistake it is on your part. It's a big blunder on your part to express gratitude to me. Then everybody looked at him and said, Swami, how could it be a blunder to express gratitude to you for all that what you did with so much of love for us? Swami said, Bangaru, it is definitely a blunder to express gratitude like this to me. You know why? It is because as God, as I see all of you as my own reflections, I began to feel thirsty. And to quench my thirst, I worked on a water project. And I worked seriously on that and began contemplating on that, worked on that for a very long time and brought water all the way from there to here. And I am drinking the water today. Today, I am quenching my own thirst. And when I quench my own thirst by drinking water, do I thank myself and express gratitude to myself? When you all people drink water and quench your thirst, it is as good as me drinking water and quenching my own thirst. How do I thank myself and express gratitude to myself? Because you are all nothing but my own reflections. Bhagavan Baba saying, you are all, that is the reason why in every discourse Bhagavan Baba used to say Divyatma Swarupulara. You are all the embodiments of divine love. You and me are one and the same. That is love. That is pure love walking on the planet. Immediately Bhagavan Baba looked at them and said one more thing. Bangaru, it is not that you should express gratitude to me, but let me tell you, it is me who should express gratitude to you. Said Swami, how can you express gratitude to us? For what? What did we do to you? And Bhagavan Baba said, I express gratitude to you for giving me this wonderful opportunity to serve you all. for blessing me with this opportunity to serve you all. I really express gratitude to all of you from the bottom of my heart. Not only that, I pray to you, I beg you to give me many, many, many more opportunities like this to serve all of you and serve my divinity in me and sanctify my divinity. At what heights Bhagavan was thinking? At what heights he was propagating love? At what heights he was preaching and practicing all his life? Did we learn anything? If we really had learned, we are sanctified. If we did not learn, we missed the bus. I think we have to seriously think on all these aspects and think of Swami 24 hours. Then we will be able to at least to some extent sanctify our lives. This is what Jesus did. When Jesus was to be crucified, he was having a small piece of loincloth on his body. There was a crown of thorns on his head. Thorns pricking into his head. Blood oozing out of that. Blood flowing over his ears. He was not able to see. His vision was a bit blurred. And he was carrying a cross, a heavy cross which was made out of the trunk of a special tree, which was very heavy. And the scorching sun. On both sides, barricades were there. People were standing. He was dragging the cross and he was walking toward the hillock on which he was to be crucified. Soldiers was lashing at him. He was bleeding. He was thirsty. Somebody ran and tried to give some water. And the soldier kicked him out. He did not allow him to give water. He gives a wonderful look to the soldier saying, "Are you happy that you kicked him out? Enjoy that happiness." He doesn't show any kind of vengeance towards him. People were throwing stones at him, pelting stones at him. He was getting bruised. He looks at the man who throws a stone and says, "Are you happy? You want to throw one more stone? You are welcome." Somebody spits on his face. He clears the spit and says, "Would you like to spit once again? I don't mind. Go ahead. I love you. I love you." At what heights Jesus was. After all that, when he was dragged to a point from where nobody was allowed, he was to be dragged onto the hillock. He just requests the soldiers to give him a minute. He puts the cross down, kneels down, extends his hands toward the sky and prays to the Lord. "O Lord, forgive them. They know not what they were doing." Pure love. Just love for the sake of love. Just love. Love them. Okay, they're ignorant. It's okay. Pray to God to bless them with more and more wisdom. At least one day or other, they would come up to a level where they would realize, they would also understand, they would drench themselves in pure love, and they would also become wonderful people. Keep on praying to God 24 hours. Please, O Swami, shower your love on all of them. Continue to love, Swami. Please, be kind to us. Being love itself, Bhagavan knows only one thing, to love and to love and love. He was loving and he continues to love and shower love through samadhi today. That's why what you need to do is, you carry Satya Sai Mahasamadhi 24 hours by Sayan, wherever you go in your hearts. That samadhi will be speaking to you from the bottom of your hearts. The samadhi will keep on blessing you from the bottom of your heart 24 hours. Get tuned to it. Enjoy. This is what the lesson which Bhagavan Baba taught us. Somehow it so happened that Prayosh said, "Sir, please talk." I thought, okay, I'll share some of my thoughts with all of you. And I thank Prayosh for giving me this wonderful opportunity to be able to share some of my thoughts with all of you. And I pray to Bhagavan Baba to shower his blessings on one and all, and bless us all, and see to it that we sanctify our lives with his love and with his blessings. Jai Sai Ram.
Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful talk, sir, for decoding the sutras, the Vedas, and the Gitas for us, defining a fundamental concept of love for us. So it's 96 years of love this year.
Yeah.
So, and you talking on love made us think once a little more, think at the deepest level, what actually love is, what and how we should love. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation and
Thanks, everybody.
I will express
my gratitude to you, one and all, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you. And also to Bhagwan. Yeah, okay. We will have prayer.
Yes, sir. Om
Sadgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrutyorma Amrutangamaya Om Shanti Shanti Shanti
Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Thank you so much, sir.
Sairam, welcome. Jai Sairam, thank you very much.